units to configure 12 signals as shown in video number 14. That's not too bad. But how is it to configure signals that are more complex than those simple searchlight signals with only one lamp and four aspects? And what about commercial signals with fixed color LEDs? Can these be converted to NeoPixels? Let's find out! Hello YouTubers and welcome to the Internet of Toy Trains. I'm Hans Tanner and here is a new episode of IoTT with fresh ideas about how to use Internet of Things components to control a model railroad layout. Let's get started! Over the course of the last few weeks, I received several interesting products for building CTC panels and signals. The first is this 8x8 pixel matrix. I plan to use them for an updated version of my CTC panel. The individual LEDs are spaced 8mm in each direction, which is twice the density compared to the LED strips I used to make the CTC panel in video number 9. Using these matrices, I can therefore reduce the spacing of the tracks and have additional LEDs for displaying signal statuses. The cost is about 5 bucks per panel, so quite reasonable. There is a link with more information in the description below. One of my viewers sent me information about 2mm NeoPixels and I was able to order some from Amazon. In those small quantities they are expensive, but in the meantime I found them on AliExpress for about 8 cents a piece in quantity of 100. Size-wise, they compare to single-color SMD LEDs, but they have RGB LEDs and a WS2811 chip on board, so they are ideal to make PCB signals even for N-scale. One of the questions that came up following my last video is how to make sure the RGB LEDs look like single-color ones. Particularly for yellow, this is a question, as yellow is the result of switching on the red and green LED simultaneously. As mentioned in some comments, the first trick is to add more red than green, probably about twice the value. This is because the human eye is more sensitive for green. In the meantime, I also experimented with various filters that act as diffuser. If you watched video number 9, you know that I used matte finish scotch tape over the LEDs and that helped somewhat. I also thought about 3D printing a lens from semi-transparent material, but in the meantime, I found a much simpler solution. I just put some glue on the lens. I experimented with hot glue, which worked, but it requires a relatively thick layer of about 2mm. Then I used Loctite Go-To All-Purpose Glue, which turned completely transparent when dry and did not have any effect on the light output. The best results I achieved with good old Elmer's glue, but it needs to be applied in several relatively thin layers as otherwise it will crack when drying. 4 or 5 layers give very good results as you can no longer distinguish the individual LEDs, which results in a pretty balanced yellow over the entire lens. Try it for yourself. Then, also from Amazon, I bought these conventional LED signals, one with 3 LEDs and the other a railroad crossing signal with 2 blinking LEDs. This one came with a blinking circuit, which I threw away as the plan is to make it work with my signaling system. The railroad signal has 3 LEDs, green over yellow over red, which really is more an upside-down traffic light than a railroad signal, at least if I compare it to aspect drawings from various railroad companies. Here the example of CSX. So, the plan is to equip it with the WS2812-2020 LEDs, which fit nicely into the signal head, converting it to 3 lamps with programmable colors. I started the process, but have to finish it yet. The railroad crossing signal conversion, on the other hand, is complete. Here is what I did. First, I separated the signal heads from the signal and removed the single color LEDs. They are glued in, so I used my milling machine to drill them out. Then I prepared the 2mm NeoPixels by soldering wires to each contact. It reminded me of a flea circus, so I taped them down on my desk for soldering. I reused the original wires from the signal, but I had to use magnifier lenses to to solder them on the 0.7mm soldering pads. It was pretty challenging, at least for me, and it made me think about making a thin PCB for the LED, which then could be glued into the signal. Maybe a future project. After that, I glued the 2mm NeoPixel into each LED hole. To connect them, I used gauge 34 wire wrap wire, which was the thinnest wire I had available. I was able to fit 4 of them into the mast and connected them to the much thinner signal wires. The problem with this approach is, of course, that I needed to solder the wires together right next to the signal head, and it is not possible to really hide all the wires. The right way to do this would be using much thinner wires and run 4 wires from each head down the mast and do the soldering at the bottom of the signal. As seen before, all LEDs are connected to 5 volts and ground, and the data line is daisy chained from one LED to the next. This means that independent of the number of LEDs on one signal head or mast, there are always 4 wires that need to be connected to the system: 5 volt ground, data in and data out. I used a simple pin header to connect the single wires to standard 3-wire light connectors, so I could fit the railroad crossing signal into my normal signal chain. Now, let's install and configure it. Okay, I admit, in the last video I was rushing a little bit through the configuration, as I wanted to show you how fast it can be done. So, before I do the crossing signal, let's go back and check out some other configuration options. First, let's assume we want to add an additional signal with 3 lamps in the second location of the chain we configured in video number 14. Here is how my same 4 aspects would be displayed on such a signal according to NOREC. And to make this more visible for you, I also have prepared a masking paper for the resulting chain, so let's configure it. First, we add a new signal after position 1 and change the signal head from 1 to 3 lamps by simply changing the number of lamps. The additional lamps will be created and displayed in the aspect drawing. I make the signal head panel a little bigger to fit 3 lamps on top of each other and place the lamps where they belong. By clicking on a lamp, I can always see the lamp number, aspect specific color and blink rate displayed. As before, I assign color and blink rate to each lamp for each aspect, but before I do that, I need to change the address mode, as this signal will be operated using normal switch commands as used for turnouts. The idea is to use 2 addresses, 610 and 611, to select 4 aspects. There are 2 modes to do so, either static or dynamic. First, I enter the addresses as a simple comma-separated list. Up to 4 addresses are supported, and they don't have to be in sequence. Next, I select the mode. Dynamic means that the signal reacts on the last switch command it receives. This is the same mode the Digitrax SE8C is using. Static, on the other hand, makes use of the full combinatorial rules of the assigned switch addresses. If you click on the options, you see the corresponding truth table displayed. For 2 addresses, the number of aspects is the same, which is 4. In the case of 3 addresses, you get 6 aspects for dynamic and 8 for static mode, and with 4 addresses, the numbers of aspects are 8 and 16 for the 2 modes. So, you have the choice, but in any case, the truth table shows what you can do based on the number of addresses and selected mode. The change delay option is to add the delay time between receiving a signal command and displaying it on the signal. The purpose is mainly for static mode addressing, when you need to change several switch addresses to select the desired aspect. Without wait time, the signal would display every aspect as you make your changes. If you set, for example, a 2-second delay, the new aspect will only be displayed 2 seconds after receipt of the last command. Now, the only remaining thing is to select the color for each lamp and each aspect and save it to the Blue Box controller. We now can operate this first signal using a regular handheld throttle, using switch address 610 and 611 as required. And what happened to the signals that were using these LEDs before? Nothing. They simply moved down the daisy chain and can still be addressed under their original address. Let's now assume there was a mistake when wiring the new signal on the layout and it ended up in position 3 of the daisy chain instead of position 2. Now, that's really simple to fix. All I need to do is using the move up or move down button to change the signal sequence in the chain. Don't worry about addresses or signal type, number of lamps, etc. They are moved including all their specifications. Okay, now for the crossing signal. The starting point again is the working chain of 12 searchlight signals. I am going to connect the crossing signal right at the beginning of the chain. I disconnect the cable coming from the blue box controller and connect the crossing signal between the current chain and the controller. As soon as it is connected, it starts showing the colors of the first two LEDs in the chain, so signals 800 and 802. On the top of the configuration screen, I now create a copy of the first signal and move the copy to the top. I change the signal heads to 2 lamps, adjust the size of the panel, and rearrange the lamps. I want to use a low range switch address for this crossing signal, as I need to activate it when I change some turnouts. Also, it only needs 2 aspects, on and off. I select address 25 in dynamic mode. Then I click on aspect 0 and make it signal off by changing both lamps to dark. When aspect 1 is selected, they should blink. So we make both lamps red and blink time of 500 milliseconds. Since they are switched on at the same time, the blinking is synchronized. To make it an alternate blinking, I simply make one of the blink times negative, so negative 500. Again, we click save and restart, and we can test address 25 for both aspects to see the result. Works like intended. Now, let's have some fun here, and at the same time give you an idea what the potential of the blue box could be for any lighting problems on your layout, signals or any kind of displays. For this, I add a second address 26 to my signal, which gives me 4 aspects. I leave aspect 0 and 1 unchanged, but for aspect 2, I add a police mode. The first LED blinking blue with 80 milliseconds, the second blinking red with 40 milliseconds. And aspect 3, I try to do a strobe light, setting both LEDs with white 20 milliseconds blink rate. I click save and restart, and this is how it looks like. So I hope this gave you some more ideas how the blue box works and how it can simplify the way we have done signaling in the past. Again, if you would like to try for yourself, you can download the software of the ESP32, including the configuration webpage from my GitHub page. You find the link in the description of this video. I am still working on finalizing the hardware of the blue box. Right now, I have some PCBs on order and plan to talk about it in one of the next videos so that you can build your own blue box with no problems. For today, here is the summary of what we have learned. We have seen just another example how using NeoPixel LEDs makes the signaling hardware more flexible and easier to install, and also makes the configuration of the system much simpler, because the colors of the LEDs can be configured after installation. Using the web app residing on the Blue Box controller, it is possible to program a wide variety of lighting effects with very little effort. The display capabilities of the WS2812 LED chain, at least to me, are impressive. Short light pulses of a few milliseconds are no problem at all, as even with about 1000 daisy chained LEDs, the system can still maintain a rate of about 30 refresh cycles per second. As always, I hope the information in this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If so, please click the like button below and subscribe to my channel. I appreciate your support as well as any feedback in the comments section below. Also, check out the additional information provided in the description section. If you don't want to miss the information about the Blue Box hardware or any other future IoTT video, click the bell icon and you will get the notification when the video comes out. Thanks for watching and see you next time.